Such a light as shows a fear. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, Bishop Trautman died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. In life, Bishop Trautman cherished the gospel of Christ. May Christ now greet him with these words of eternal life. Come, blessed of my Father.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Good afternoon, and welcome to this funeral mass of Bishop Trautman. I also want to welcome those who are viewing this mass by live streaming. In the name of the clergy, religious, and laity of the Diocese of Erie, and in my own name, we want to express to Bishop Trautman's nephew Mark, his niece Catherine, his family and friends, our heartfelt sympathy and promise of prayers for the repose of the soul of Bishop Trautman. Also, I want to express the gratitude of the Diocese of Erie for the presence of my brother bishops, Bishop Mark Barczyk of Altoona Johnstown, Bishop Lawrence Brandt, Bishop Emeritus of Greensburg, Bishop Robert Cunningham, Bishop Emeritus of Syracuse, Bishop Michael Fisher, Bishop of Buffalo, Bishop Edward Gross, Auxiliary Bishop Emeritus of Buffalo, Bishop Larry Kulik, Bishop of Greensburg, and Bishop Edward Malesic, Bishop of Cleveland. My brother priests and deacons from Erie and Buffalo, the consecrated religious and laity, to all of you, thank you. Thank you for your presence and prayerful participation in the funeral mass as we pray for the repose of Bishop Trautman. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that the soul of your departed servant, Bishop Trautman, to whom you committed the care of your family, may, with the manifold fruit of his labors, enter into the eternal gladness of his Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will provide all peoples. On this mountain, he will destroy the veil that veils all peoples, the web that is woven over all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces. The reproach of his people he will remove from the whole earth. For the Lord has spoken. On that day it will be said, "Behold our God, to whom we looked to save us. This is the Lord for whom we looked. Let us rejoice and be glad that he has saved us." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
there's nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. Fresh and green are the pastures where he gives me repose. Near restful waters he leads me to revive my drooping spirit. I should walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. You are there with your crook and your staff. With these you give me comfort. The Lord is my shepherd. Sight of my foes, my cup you have anointed with oil, my cup is overflowing. Surely goodness and kindness shall follow me all the days of my life.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who can be against us? God did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all. Will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, rather was raised, who also is at the right hand of God, who intercedes for us. What will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish or distress or persecution or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or the sword. No, in all these things, we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor present things, nor future things, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. That very day, the first day of the week, two of the disciples of Jesus were going to a village called Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on farther. But they urged him, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that, while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. But he vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?" So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them, who were saying, "The Lord has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon." Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. the gospel of the Lord.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, good afternoon and welcome. Thank you for the gift of your presence and prayers this evening. To Mark and Kate, the bishop's nephew and niece, our prayers and sincere condolences. We share your sorrow. Believe me, we also share your faith. We know well your love for the bishop, and you know, I'm sure, how special you were to him, to us as well. We look to our faith this day for a measure of comfort and consolation. Faith, the bishop firmly embraced. Faith he lived and preached so well. Faith that assures us that he lives, is alive in Christ, more alive than ever before, alive forever. Chapter 13 of the Epistle to the Hebrews cautions us to remember those who brought us God's message. Consider the outcome of their lives, it says. Imitate their faith. For Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. I hope to attempt a measure of this in what I am about to say. To remember the person of Bishop Trautman, the life and ministry of a humble and faithful servant. Bishop Trautman was the youngest of three children. Not surprisingly, his mother and father were devout Catholics. Mass regularly, recitation of the rosary every evening, active in the various ministries within their parish. But before they became moderately surprised when their youngest son announced one evening that he would like to enter the seminary. They were so pleased to hear, but they were very concerned that he may be too young. He was entering the ninth grade. Wait until you graduate from high school, they pleaded. Guess who won? The bishop was ordained to the priesthood in Innsbruck, Austria, on April 7th, 1962. But you know, the passing of the years from that moment when he wanted to enter the seminary, the passing of the years through the seminary, the passing of years until the time of his death, his appreciation of the Lord's call to priesthood never waned, never waned. Like clockwork, every year on the anniversary of his ordination, the bishop would bring out his photo albums with pictures of his ordination and first mass. Talk about being excited You would have sworn he was ordained that very morning. I will never forget, after showing all the pictures and the albums and so forth, he always ended the session every year with the words, "To Christ is the glory." Grateful for his call to priestly ministry. You know, deep down, the bishop was a humble man. Anytime anyone attempted to compliment him or acknowledge his accomplishments, academic or otherwise, he grew uncomfortable. He used to say, "No, no, 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 no." He said that to me when I thought I had a good idea. He never liked being the center of attention. Anyone who would compliment him, he would always say something like, "All thanks belongs to God. The attention and the focus must be on God, not on me." He pushed it away. All because of God, not because of him. The bishop was a teacher at heart, well-educated, well-respected by his brother bishops, often invited to parishes in our 13 county dioceses and dioceses across the country for worship, for workshops, for retreats to clergy and laity. One of his popular talks, and many of the dioceses remember it, was his talk on the Second Vatican Council, the ins and outs, the hopes and the dream of the Second Vatican Council. Well attended, well received. You would never know, but Notre Dame University, Catholic University of America, St. John's University in New York, Georgetown University Center for Liturgy, honored him for outstanding contributions in the area of scripture, liturgy, and sacramental theology. You would never know it. Never a plaque or a diploma or whatever on his wall that I can remember. He was twice elected by the Conference of Catholic Bishops to chair the committees on liturgy and doctrine, perhaps the two most important committees at the conference. He was chosen to chair them. Here at home in the Diocese of Erie, he started the Catholic chapel at the Mill Creek Mall. I don't know if you remember that or not. It was short-lived, but very popular. And what a wonderful move it was on his part to try to move the church to where the people are. And it was a great experience for so many, walking, shopping at the mall, looking at the chapel, coming in perhaps just to rest in the presence of the Blessed Sacrament, always to receive the sacrament of reconciliation, to share their worries, their difficult moments with a priest, a deacon, woman religious, laymen and women. It was very popular. People from New York, Ohio, came to shop, they came to make themselves available to a moment of prayer in a place where so many people walk and talk. Faith and Faith Life Bulletin began under the direction of Bishop Trautman and continues today to enter the homes of so many people with articles that on parish life, articles on the movement of the church in this part of the world, timely news events of the local and universal church. He began rural ministry out there, well beyond the Erie County. Rural ministry to care for people who were further down and around the diocese, to make sure that the church came out to be with them. He began the permanent diaconate program in 1992. So also the Office for the Protection of Children, the Catholic Foundation, so many other offices, always in service to the people, whether in Erie or Coalport or Genesee. So many accomplishments of the bishop. What about the person? Who was Bishop Trautman? Because that's more important, perhaps, than what he did. Who was he? Well, let me begin with this. The Mass was at the center of his life, always. Many a time he would come into my room when he got back in Erie from a meeting, 9:30, 10 o'clock, he would stop in my room. Anything new? Anything different? Anything I should know? And after he got no to everything, he said, I have to go say Mass, celebrate Mass, 10 o'clock at night. I can't remember his ever failing to say Mass, with one exception, when he was at St. Mary's Asbury, and the virus was sort of running its course. He went almost a year without celebrating Mass. And he said to me, the two things I miss here are celebrating Mass and hearing confessions. One time I had the opportunity to help him say Mass, and so we celebrated in the chapel with Kay and Patty McGinnis and others who were part of his ministry at St. Mary's. I said to the bishop, you want me to read the gospel? No, I'll read the gospel. Okay. You want me to give some reflections? I'll give the reflections. Okay. Want me to take the intercessory prayers? I'll take them. He wanted every part of the Mass, because it had been so long for him to do those kinds of things. And he did it himself. And if any gift could have been given to him, it was that gift, that privilege to celebrate Mass. He missed it. He missed it. And he hungered to do it again. Hungered to do it again. He was tireless when it came to work at the office. Really, Sunday afternoon, where was he? At the office. Time for the closing of St. Mark's for a holiday, Holy Day, where was he? At the office. Always, always at the office. He took a lot of calls and answered most of the calls. Some were difficult calls. Some were calls about requests for help. He always was able either to take the call or would get back to the person later in the day. Always available to talk. Good times and bad times. He was very conscious of praying when people would request prayers, whatever their need. People will say, you know, I have a sick baby or things aren't going well. Would you pray for me? Yeah, the bishop would say, yeah, yeah. But much more than that, not only he prayed for them, but a week or two later when he would run into them in the hall, he says, how's your mother? How's she doing? Been praying for her. And you know, that meant so much to the people. People would come up and say, gosh, Bishop said to me, how's your mother? I saw him 3 weeks ago and asked him to pray, and he did. But he asked me, how is my mother? How's my son? How's my daughter? It wasn't just a momentary, okay, I'll pray. It was from the heart. He took their concern to heart, and he prayed for them. The bishop knew what it was to suffer in Gethsemane. He had the Gethsemane experience. He knew what it was to climb Calvary Hill. He knew that as well. And he knew how to bear the cross of Jesus Christ. Yeah? Yeah. There were difficult times, difficult days. And he suffered. Yet he managed always to turn to God in prayer and do what he could possibly do and as best as he could. Kay Caberline, whom we saw this morning reading, a faithful assistant but a personal friend of the bishop, always there, as well as Patty McGinnis and so many others. She couldn't keep up with the thank you notes the bishop wanted to send to people. People who stopped in to see him, people that gave him a gift or a phone call. Always thank you, and I'll pray for you. That was how the letters ended. But you know, the one moment in the life of the bishop that really impressed me the most, and if it ever defined his character, as far as I'm concerned, it was this. And it all began with a cheese and bologna sandwich. Let me explain. It was the practice at the bishop's residence, long before the bishop came, to offer a kind of sandwich to many hungry who came to the residence. And mostly that was bologna and cheese, 8 o'clock in the morning, if you can imagine that. Early morning, the doorbell would ring, and standing there would be a man or a woman, sometimes both, sometimes with children. Can we have something to eat? And usually it was that kind of sandwich and a cup of coffee. The bishop became aware of what we were doing. And after watching what was going on, he said, you know, this is good, but I think we can do better. Well, several days later, having discussed the practice of the sandwich, lunch, breakfast, he discussed it with the administrative cabinet. And then he called the director of St. Mark's Center to see how he might better care for the many coming. With a variety of needs, they came for food, clothing, looking for a place to just sit down and rest. That marked the beginning of what came to be known as the bishop's hot breakfast program. Hot breakfast. Much different than cold sandwich, bologna and cheese. A hot breakfast. Sit down like others. And it was housed at the St. Paul United Church of Christ. Then he said, well, that's good. But then he said, there's something not right about what we're doing. Something's missing. He said, we're feeding the body, but not caring for the soul, the person. Mother Teresa said it this way. She said, you know, we sometimes think that poverty is only being hungry, naked, and homeless. The greatest poverty, she said, is the poverty of being unwanted, unloved, and uncared for. Well, out came the bishop again. I think we can do better. He called Catholic Charities, the Catholic Charities office down the street, and he inquired about the possibility of having counselors and volunteers at the breakfast with the people, to be on site, helping them maybe with the problems they were having, helping them with family issues, helping them perhaps to gain employment somewhere, somehow to sit, listen, hear their needs, and however the counselors could handle them, to work with them to accomplish it. If it wasn't that, it was another extension of his compassion and caring, a caring presence seeking to find those who are lost. But you know what it was to me? You find in the Gospel of Matthew. I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you said, come on, come on, welcome, welcome, welcome. How can we help? In need of clothing, you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Whatever you did for one of the least of these, my brothers or sisters, you did it for me. You know, the bishop was always looking for ways to help people, believe me. If he would hear of someone in need in his visitation to the parish, he would learn about the family, the person in need. He would talk to the parish priest and say, how can we help these people? I heard them say this, what can we do? Sometimes he would come in and mention a name. I said, do you know this person at all? No, I don't. But he was talking to the dean, he was talking to the parish priest, he was talking to Sister Nancy Fisher, and she told me about that person. And so he would say to Nancy or to those who knew, how can we help them? What can we do to help them get along? And then he would call the people who mentioned the name and say, can we do anything? What can we do? What can we do? You know, at the last Emmaus convocation for clergy at St. Vincent's in Latrobe, he had this to say, and it was really critically important what he said. He said, we are co-workers, not messiahs. We will not solve all the problems, never earn a perfect score on the pastoral evaluation form, and we won't be accepted by anyone. Then he said, this truth should keep us humble, focused, and holy. God allows us to journey, said the bishop. God allows us to journey with the people. That's our task, to walk with the people, and through their moments of joy and sorrow, their good times and setbacks, all the way to the moment when God calls us home. What he defined there was the role that all of us play, clergy, religious, and laity, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ. We are called to journey with one another, good times and in bad, companions and friends, along the road, along their Emmaus road, until such time as God calls us home. God allows all of us to journey with his people, to walk with them. Moments of joy and sorrow, good times and bad. That's the ministry of all of us, ordained, religious, laity, married, single, divorced, the ministry to walk with each other. Many, many people are on the Emmaus road, and we are to be in persona Christi, in the person of Christ, to join them on the journey and to bring them back to the love of the church and God's love for them. That was his understanding of ministry. It's a journey. Whether we're clergy, religious, or lay, all of us need, to the degree possible, to have a companion on the journey, to walk with one another. All members of the church are called to do that. You know, what Jesus left to the Emmaus disciples was something more than a powerful memory, something more than just a memory. He left the disciples with faith in him. He left them with hope in the resurrection, and he left them with the assurance of his love for them. That's why they got up and ran out back to Jerusalem. We've met the risen Christ. He's with us. Let us walk the journey with each other. Did you ever wonder about the difference in the two disciples on the road? When they were walking toward Emmaus, they were in despair. And then, after meeting Christ, they couldn't run faster to get back to Jerusalem. What changed them? What changed them to go from despair to joyful news? It was the Eucharist. Jesus broke bread with them, and in doing so, gave them his life for all days. It was Jesus who was alive, who went into their life, and out went they to the lives of others. And here we are today, many of us on the Emmaus Road, many out there, we're called to bring the good news to our people so that they might come to believe as the disciples did. What happened? Their doubt, the disciples' doubt, was overcome with faith. Their despair turned to hope because of the Jesus who sat and celebrated the Eucharist. And their fear dissipated because of Christ's love for them. Faith, hope, and love, they always work and work well together. Our faith, our hope, our love for Christ, and his love for the people. Christ never lost faith in the Emmaus disciples. He never lost faith. They wanted to go home, forget it. It's all a nice job, but there's nothing to it. Christ never lost faith in them. Lord, do we lose faith in us? Stay with us, the disciples asked, and he did. Stay with us, we ask, he does and always will. We need always to remember we never walk alone. There may be thousands of reasons to be pessimistic, multiple problems in the world, you name it. There's one reason always for hope. The risen Lord is with us. We're never alone, never. St. Pope John Paul II, he once said of shepherds of the church that they must be heralds of the gospel who know the depth of the human heart, who can share the joy, the hope, the agonies, the distress of people today, and who are at the same time prayerful people who have fallen in love with God. Bishop Trautman was that kind of good shepherd. He fed us in so many ways, mind, heart, and soul. Today we commend him to the Lord. Now, the bishop had a habit of reciting little bits of verse from time to time. He told most of the priests when they came to his office, "Don't look at my desk." I did that one time looking over here, and he said, "What do you see over there?" I said, "I'm not allowed to look at your desk." But one of his favorite verses, and one that seems most appropriate this afternoon, was this. He said, "Remember, remember, never forget. The Lord cannot be outdone in his generosity." Always said that. Whatever the troubles people had, he said, "No, remember, the Lord cannot be outdone in his generosity." Well, this evening I would suggest the bishop will experience up close and personal the Lord's generosity. He'll say, "Come, good bishop. Blessed are my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for the foundation of the world. Come, good shepherd, come, bishop, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." May he rest now in peace. Amen.
My sisters and brothers, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church, confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus. We join our prayers to his.
For Pope Francis, Bishop Persico, and all bishops, that they may be given the strength to express in action the word they proclaim. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For elected officials everywhere, that they will pursue the paths of peace and turn away from war and conflict. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our brother Donald, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Donald, who shared in the priesthood of Jesus Christ and served the church as a successor to the blessed apostles, that he may now take his place in the heavenly liturgy. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of Bishop Trautman, heal their pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an increase in vocations to the priesthood, the diaconate, and the religious life, that the people of God will always have faithful servants to share with them the gospel of Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us here, strengthen our hope that we may live in expectation of your Son's coming. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom. through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. We humbly beseech your boundless mercy, Lord, that this sacrifice, which your departed servant and bishop, Donald, while in the body, offered to your majesty for the salvation of the faithful, may now bring him to your pardon through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, and with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Lawrence, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
Remember your servant Donald, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body of Christ be saved for eternal life. Let us pray. May your merciful kindness, which we have implored, O Lord, benefit the soul of your departed servant, Bishop Donald, that by these sacrificial gifts, he may know the eternal company of Christ, in whom he hoped and whom he preached, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Before we take Bishop Trautman to his place of rest and go our separate ways, I would just like to take this opportunity for some special thank yous. Thank you to Monsignor Robert Smith for his homily and the insight that he has given us with Bishop Trautman's great love for the scripture and his priesthood. Also, I would like to take this opportunity to thank Kay and Fred Caberline and Patty McGinnis. Thank you for your care and your special interest and charity in caring for Bishop Trautman these last few years. Thank you. Also to Alan Benance and the staff at St. Mary's Home for their care of Bishop Trautman. For Father Michael Farrick and the cathedral staff, to Dr. Richard Rossi and the Cathedral Choir, and Father Christopher Singer and his planning committee for the funeral arrangements for these last 2 days. I want to thank all of you for your great kindness as we bid farewell to our beloved Bishop Emeritus Donald Trump. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Donald. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Come to his aid and save, Lord God.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother, Bishop Donald, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Bishop Trautman in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Hello. Hello? Okay. Everyone, sorry, could I have your attention? Could you all just remain in the cathedral up here until they are finished in the crypt? And once they are done, then we can all go downstairs for lunch. But we all have to go through the same area, so we need them to be done with the entombment first. Thank you.
longing for the coming of God's kingdom. Let us pray. Our trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation. God of holiness and power, accept our prayers on behalf to him, O Lord. Rest in peace. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace of Christ.